You're listening to Sustainably Geeky, the podcast for everyday environmentalists.
Hi, you're listening to Sustainably Geeky. This is episode 50, and we're joined today by Oli Frost, who is the guy who impersonated his local council, played recorder for Simon Cowell, and put all his personal data on eBay. His work has been featured everywhere from UK Parliament to Britain's Got Talent, BBC to Fox News, in art shows, and on bins. And most recently, you might recognize his work from Instagram and other social media, where he turned climate action into an aerobics routine, predicted how his followers would die, and generated a million plant-based recipes. So, Oli, thank you so much for being on the show. And can you kind of just tell us a little bit more about yourself? What is your origin story?
Okay. Thank you for having me. My origin story, if you go back a long way, I studied philosophy some years ago and left university knowing that maybe I wanted to do something other than banking, law, and medicine, just because, not because those aren't lovely things to do, but because everybody else was doing those. And I started working in an ad agency for a little bit. And as you know, over time, you know, that hasn't worked out as a particularly interesting way to make work for a while. So, but it did lead to something else, which is that I was working on an internship, and they had this project about go out in the world and save the world for no money, and we might give you a job if you succeed, which they didn't in the end. But I started working on this project that's quite unrelated to what I do now, but it was about what homeless people do when they're on their period, period poverty was not an issue that anyone had heard of at the time. So I made this website and an online petition that kind of, as much as I've ever had, you know, quote unquote, blew up and got mentioned in Parliament and turned into this movement that was around the world that, you know, traveled. And I think that started me on this path that led me here, because it kind of showed me that, you know, me sitting at home and making some websites and some videos had a little bit of potential to expand my, you know, personal sphere of influence beyond the very limited one it has otherwise. And that sort of sent me down this long path of making different projects that kind of leads me to here.
Yeah, so your activism may have started with a different topic, but it sounds like, you know, the climate crisis is something you're really passionate about, and you decided to kind of focus your energy there.
Yeah, it's I think like a lot of, I mean, it's something that's been on my mind for a long time, but as I think many people could say, it wasn't until a few years ago that, you know, people became aware that it was something that you had to get involved with. So there was a switch from the kind of projects that I was working on before that, and then I tried to apply the things I enjoyed about those to starting this new project, which is I call this Oli Frost Refrost the Planet project.
So how did you come up with that concept of refrosting the planet?
It's all like I'm doing quite a terrible job of explaining it so far, but it's quite like long context of trying to find a project that was both, you know, useful and a good thing to work on, and also something rewarding to myself. So my previous project was I was playing hip-hop songs on the recorder as under the name Recorder Boy. Um, and I'd had some projects before that, which were again like separate to myself, or they were one step removed from myself, and I'd read a piece of advice to kind of, you know, put yourself into your work a little bit. And so Refrosting the Planet was kind of how I got there, by that spin on my own name.
No, I like that. And yeah, it's playing to what you're interested in and your strengths, and also, you know, it's playing words that people can kind of, that make people kind of stop and think. You know, obviously you said you started out making websites and doing some other things creatively, and now you've kind of moved into, I think what one of your pages says is the eco-friendly novelty music genre. So you have a couple of songs that have gone viral, one about Greta Thunberg.
It's getting wetter and wetter. You've got to listen, listen, listen. Listen, listen to Greta. Lots of people are dead. They're getting deader and deader. You've got to listen, 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 listen to Greta.
So where do you get your inspiration? Do you have any other, you know, folks in this genre that you look up to? Or how do you think of, you know, like what you want to sing about?
Obviously it's a niche genre. I think my inspiration would probably go back to school, when I was into Flight of the Conchords quite a lot, and I loved how they explored a different genre or style with each song. So I owe a great debt to them all, and yeah, a great deal of time wasted quoting that show.
It's interesting, yeah, that we can get inspiration from different places, and humor really is, like, I think, so important when we're talking about topics that are so serious, like climate change, even though it's not a funny topic, but it helps kind of, you know, I don't know, bring people around or get them more relaxed and able to talk about it rather than just constant doom and gloom. You kind of need both, but I think the humor helps lighten it a little and get people a little more willing to listen. So you have a unique style of communicating important issues in a way that's accessible to a wide audience. Why do you think it is important to communicate these issues creatively rather than just using like more traditional forms of communication? I mean, now that we have social media and the internet, you know, folks can do a lot more than they could 20, 30 years ago, when the only way to reach people was through mass media.
Yeah, I think two reasons for that, or maybe it's actually the same reason, but I guess I'm communicating it now in a way that is the same as I was doing before I started working on this project. So, you know, I was doing this recorder boy thing, but when I turned it into Refrost the Planet, that was just continuing the skills or things that I was learning to do in that project and applying it to this issue. So it was about doing communicating in a way that I was good at or was natural for me. And I think the other reason to communicate it differently is I'm trying to communicate it in a way that would appeal to someone like myself, because I don't respond to doom and gloom necessarily. It's part of it, but things communicated in a very straight way kind of put people off. And I think especially with the environment, where it's got this legacy of cliched environmental activists, you know, as a, you know, our own prime minister called it like bunny hugging or something. Like it's really tropey. And I think the job that I was going for is we need to be able to, it's just quite unique in that we need to bring everybody into the fold. So there has to be different things for different people. And I'm just trying to fill the niche of making things that would appeal to me.
No, I love that. Yeah, there's definitely people who respond better, like you said, to different forms of communication. So when you are, trying to raise awareness for different issues, there's so many things that come up when we start talking about climate change and environment. So how do you decide which issues to focus on? Is there like a light bulb moment, or do you just kind of like have a list of things ongoing?
I think I've noticed that certainly at least with the songs, the things that have motivated each of them have probably been reading something usually reading something or getting a new piece of information where it's kind of makes you think like there are so many things that people already think about climate change or environmental issues or like things that people accept, and then every now and then there's a fact that kind of surprises you and makes you think, oh, I thought the issue was all about this, but maybe it's a little more about that. So this song I wrote about pirates who are climate conscious, I think was a few days after I'd watched Seaspiracy. So I'm assuming it's not a coincidence there.
Every pirate was the same. We could not wait for climate change. The seas will swallow all the land. We cherry raise our hooks and hands. One day a girl boarded the ship, a Swede heading to us amid. She said, you've got the whole thing wrong. Well, you looked when everyone's gone. Hi, ho, what's happening on the hoi seas? Don't, you know, it's a pirate emergency.
The one I wrote about, it was a kind of a synth pop odyssey about all greenhouse gas emissions broken down by industrial sector by year. And I think that was from, I think it was Bill Gates's book, or whether or not you love it or leave it, but talking about how something like iron and steel has cement has such a huge footprint, but we focus on other things. So I guess, yeah, trying to focus on those things that go beyond what people already know, which is tricky because it's easier to talk about what we already know and accept. But, we got in Inconvenient Truth or whatever, like polar bears stranded on ice, on icebergs and penguins and stuff like that. And if I ever look at something and say like, oh, that's a little bit more like 90s climate change communication, or that's like a little bit noughties, try and put that aside, and focus on things that move us beyond that basic point of, hey, the earth's getting hot, blah 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 blah, because so much of it is like that.
Yeah, that's great, because I mean, times change and knowledge changes, and we need to reflect that, the polar bears do still need our help. There's so many other things happening too that people, like when you see a polar bear, I think people feel removed from it. Like, how does that affect me? But when you start singing about, these more specific things that they may not realize connect to them, that's, I think, how you start to reach more people and get those folks who are on the fringe, who aren't paying attention, or who are just kind of like, oh, the environmental issues, don't apply to me, kind of thing. you've done, speaking of, some of the cool things that you've done to kind of get people's attention and sometimes it's for a cause, but sometimes it seems like it's more for fun or for, a creative outlet. You've had a lot of other projects that you've done a lot over the years, such as you did a crowdfunding site called flopstarter.com and lifefaker.com. Do you want to talk about any of these projects that are ongoing and kind of, what they are or why you decided to start them?
Yeah. So the ones you mentioned, Flopstarter was kind of like a crowdfunding site for bad ideas, of which I was like having a lot of at the time. But some of the examples were like coconut shampoo for coconuts, or like a timeless watch without hands, or natural death beef, which is made from cows that have just died in their sleep, or like had a little tumble. Or there was a fashion range that was, yeah, just clothes that, that people had already died in. And I guess that was all about, that project is I was having a lot of these individual thoughts, and I thought, oh yeah, and I realized it's not time to make everything into a project. Sometimes you have to use social media as kind of a testing ground to see what's interesting. So the idea was that I'd just put up the crowd, I'd make my own, you couldn't get on Kickstarter, so I made my own site where you could just put up the idea of the thing. And that was a way of putting out work quicker. And then
did anyone get funded or?
Well, there was a guy who did put, so one of them was called Cloud Fallen Water. And it was just like, it was just rainwater essentially, but like he put down some of the money for it. And then he tries to take it out or something. And it turned out he works in water economics or something. He was a university professor. And then he spoke to me about a lot of very interesting things about water economics that I knew nothing about, and how he thought this idea could be helpful for communicating them. And some people did put their card details down for the natural death beef, which is like several thousand. But yeah, it doesn't take the money unless it gets fully funded. But yeah, strange things happen when you put them up on the internet. And it still gets maybe like 1,000, had like 1,000 or so submissions, many of which are not just bad ideas, they're just absolute garbage, and I couldn't even post them. But and that the other one you mentioned, lifefaker.com, was I think started prior to that one, because it took me a very long time to make, and which is what led me to making Flopstarter, which let me make things quite quickly. But Lifefaker was a site where you could buy packages of Instagram photos. So instead of living an amazing life, you could just post other people's photos. And I've wanted to kind of like rework that as something called, like, maybe it'd be called Instagreen or something. So instead of going on holiday and doing all these not particularly sustainable ways of living, or being wealthy, you could just steal other people's Instagram photos. And again, strange people, things happened there where people really did email in and want to sell me their photos for me to put up on this site. But yeah, those projects are part of a legacy that brought me here, because I think I stopped doing things like that just because making websites was unrewarding to me, because it was like just like destroying my neck, and just being like just doing code was just like didn't seem like a way to live. So that was what the predecessor to me doing the recorder thing, which was more performance based and more fun for me to do. So I guess my moral there at least is that, yeah, if you're going to start a project on climate change, or it's going to be something that you're going to work on for a long time, it has to be something, this is obvious, isn't it? But it has to be something that you physically enjoy doing, as well as being something that you think you should do. Just as if this podcast has been running for, I think you said 4 years, you know, you must enjoy the process of talking to people, even if I'm sure editing it is quite grueling sometimes.
Yeah, for sure. I've come a long way in the technical side of it, and I still don't feel like I know what I'm doing half the time. But yeah, it is rewarding to talk to folks doing this work and to feel like maybe I'm amplifying their voice a little bit, that someone out there hears it and maybe it inspires them or it helps them in their sustainability journey. Even if it's just one or two people, you know, it all kind of has a domino effect. And yeah, I think it is, like what you said, very important that we focus on what we're good at, because there's so many ways to volunteer and spend your time on causes. Like so many causes too. Once you pick a cause, then it's like, okay, how do I help? And if you're not the person that's good at knocking on doors or writing postcards or doing, you know, whatever form of activism you think you have to do, then you may be turned off from even trying. But if you can find that one thing or those two things that you actually enjoy, then I think it makes all the difference, because you're going to be more invested and do it, you know, yeah, for longer probably. So that said, you know, at least I thank you for what you've done in the past, if for nothing else, that it was, you know, fun and interesting to look at. And I realized that maybe it's not where your heart is now, but it, everything kind of brings us, I think, to where we are today. So it all kind of gives us the experience to, and the confidence to try the next thing and the next thing. So yeah, appreciate all the stuff you've done in the past as well as what you're doing now. You kind of already touched on this, but is there any other advice you would offer folks who are interested in refrosting the planet in their own way?
Yeah, I think if I'm remembering how I started this project, as I've said a few times, I was doing this recorder thing, and then I just seemingly to other people, I just switched and said, hey, this is Oli Frost Refrost the Planet now. And I think the worry was people are going to be like, is this a joke or something? Because, oh, they're going to think, well, you've not talked about this like before. Are you just trying to get on something that's popular? And I think those are thoughts that would go through anyone's mind. And I think that's probably a barrier for some people. And I think, yeah, the thing to realize is it's just the kind of issue where the past kind of has to be put behind, because if we just look for model perfect people who've had, you know, no guilt or involvement in this, then we'll be down to a very small list of people who can get involved. So I think that was eventually, you know, a few years on from now, that's not a thought, and it's just something that people, you know, accept that is a thing. And I think usually also with getting involved in a cause, you know, usually you have to have a story that connects you, or why you personally are related to that issue, or how it's affected you in your life. And I don't think this is another exception where that's not really necessary. You know, I think we all just need to, we just recognize that it's something that everybody needs to be involved with, and you don't have to have that, you know, something that says, hey, I'm a professor of sustainability, and that's why I do this. Or hey, I'm qualified in this way. It's I guess that's my advice: is not to let, if there's something that's on your mind, not to really let that get in the way.
Yeah, imposter syndrome is real, and it holds a lot of folks back from trying new things. So that's a great reminder. Just get out there and do it. I just had a question that's been bothering me for a while since I saw this video that you did, and I was very concerned. But you, speaking of doing videos for things that people may not realize affect the climate or have anything to do with the environment, you did a video a while back where you said you would give up cheese for every hour, or for an hour, for every like, I think, that you got on that post. And I was very saddened because I love cheese, but I'm just wondering, how many hours did you have to give up cheese for, and how did you make it through that grueling ordeal?
I don't know how many it was now, but I think it was maybe four or five months. But you know, and that's without me having a huge following. I might try it again, but it is a risky move. I'm eating a lot. I mean, I've tried now the alternatives, and I think certain cheeses I can quite safely say that you can substitute very easily, like mozzarella or a feta. And that's kind of what I've done at the end of this, is like a very, I don't think it's of interest to anyone, but my, like a very flexible vegan diet that sort of at the moment looks like not really eating meat much at all, but occasionally, and then substituting the things that you can easily substitute, whereas you can easily substitute milk or cheese, and then certain things like, well, I was going to say I plan to become a pizzatarian and just that be like the one non-vegan thing I eat, but I actually have had some pretty good vegan pizzas of lately. So I actually just switch. Sometimes I would eat a vegan pizza and sometimes I wouldn't. I mean, this has turned into quite like a indulgent discussion of my current like diet, but I'm finding it interesting because people are not, maybe people find that concept quite alien because they would like you to just be a vegan or a vegetarian or something like that. And if that makes sense, if you're specifically doing it for like an ethical reason, but if you're doing it for an environmental reason, you're just playing a matter of reduction. So you know, each instance does make a difference in a way. So that's my long-winded and overly personal answer.
No, that's very relatable, especially for me, because I love cheese, I love pizza, and those are the things that when I think about going vegan or vegetarian are the hardest for me to get past. And I know that's kind of an entitled privileged thing, but you know, I've also had to kind of accept that I'm, you know, just doing the best I can at this point in my life in maintaining a more sustainable diet. And part of that is, like you said, reducing the amount of meat that I eat and dairy. And I don't know that my mental health could manage, you know, completely shifting my diet to a vegan diet at this point, but I'm giving myself the grace to kind of, and I think that's an important message for folks, is like, you don't have to do it all perfectly all the time, but you know, do the best you can and reduce, and maybe be a pizzatarian or whatever you, whatever one thing you can't give up, give yourself that, because you know, we can't live in denial all the time. do you have any resources or other, you know, influencers or people you would suggest for people to look up that you would want to share with our listeners so they can like learn more about the issues that we're talking about?
There is loads there. I think, I don't know, the last, I'm not sure if it be for everyone, but it, the last book I read was this book by Jason Hickel, I think, called Less is More. I didn't really like the title. I didn't really like how the cover looked. I didn't really like any bad thing about it from the outside, but it's an interesting book on degrowth, essentially, and talking about just the like practical impossibility of trying to constantly grow the economy while keeping up with renewable energy demand, and some particularly like interesting chapters on you know, if we continue to grow the economy by 2050, just how much lithium, and you know, also, for example, you'd need to keep 2 billion electric cars on the road, or you know, things like that, just the the challenge of not just replacing everything we're currently using, but, you know, accounting for infinite economic growth. And I describe the book as kind of like Naomi Klein on easy mode. It's more like briefly easy, plain reading, and like quite like simply argued, and maybe a little bit less poetic. And the words are bigger in the book as well. I thought that Naomi Klein's book, the words were very small, but a very good book. But I don't know. That's why I'm in my reading at the moment.
Yeah, that book is actually on my list as well, because I, funnily enough, used some of his academic papers in some papers I wrote last semester. So, yeah, I've been kind of familiarizing myself with the degrowth concept, and it is interesting because you hear a lot about sustainable growth, but really that still requires growth, and degrowth is just like stopping all that and saying we can still survive without continuously consuming. So interesting concept, and we may have to do a show on that at some point. So I guess we'll move on now to the part of the show where we share a green life hack with listeners. So this is where we kind of just give listeners one action or resource or something they can do to live more sustainably. So, Oli, would you like to share your green life hack for our listeners?
I guess I'm ill-prepared for that. I suppose my useful, more useful green life hack was my flexigan or pizzatarian idea that I've just shared. But one on my mind today was that, like, TV shows, they take a lot to produce. Like, they very, you know, expensive ordeals. What if we focused on reusing the existing TV shows we have and just consumed more memes instead? You know, memes that take clips, you know, screenshots. I think that's a more sustainable way to internet than, you know, Netflix, who are just like pumping out Is It Cake and, you know, shows like this. Just, and they're just throwing away a lot of cake in that show. I kept thinking about, I don't know if you saw this, Is It Cake, where they try to guess whether the thing is cake or not, and they're just like making these massive cakes. And I kind of imagine someone is taking a cake home at the end, or, but I also imagine the runners kind of like, oh, anyone want some of this cake? And everyone's like, I really got to go home, it's like 11. So yeah, that's my tip.
No, I haven't seen that show. I haven't watched much TV at all the last few years, but the food shows give me anxiety because of the waste that I see. And I'm just like you, like, oh God, I hope someone on the set takes that home when they make, you know, an entire meal just to show you one step or something. So yeah, I like the idea of recycling TV clips into memes. My green life hack is just a reminder to folks, since this is an election year, a midterm election year in the U.S. and around the world, I know there's a lot of elections happening as well. Just a reminder to folks to kind of start researching the candidates now and getting familiar with who is climate friendly and who is not. And maybe, you know, asking people that are running for office some hard questions and just kind of letting them know that these are the issues that their constituents are thinking about. And yeah, if you start researching now who is, you know, those things are important to, then it won't be as difficult come November or whenever your election cycle is to pick who you're going to vote for. It's usually pretty obvious, at least in the U.S. But you never know. I don't want to, you know, just say that everything's on party lines. So do your research and just start kind of looking into that stuff now. So, all right. Well, that's all that I have, Oli, and I really appreciate you again sharing your time with us and giving us an inside look into what you do and how folks can kind of start to, you know, become activists in their own way. Where can we find you online and kind of experience more of your work?
On all the platforms, I'm Oli Frost, but spelt O-L-I, Frost, and there's a dot in there before the S and the T, but Oli Frost, and your social platform of choice, but I think primarily on Instagram or more recently TikTok, because they seem to be being a lot kinder to people that put things on their platform at the moment. But that's me.
All right. Well, I can be found on Instagram and Twitter at Hetz Gonna Be Me. And of course, here on Sustainably Geeky, occasionally on our parent show, Epically Geeky, and then our book club, Marginally Geeky. I'll be on next month for a funny book by Nick Offerman. The show itself can be found on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Sustainably Geeky. We're also on YouTube and anywhere you listen to podcasts. So please do look us up, subscribe, give us a 5-star rating, thumbs up, et cetera, et cetera. Share with your friends. We really appreciate your support. And if you have topic ideas for us, shoot me an email or a message through social media, and we will definitely take a look. Thank you for listening, and have a great rest of your day.